The Price of Fear. Vincent Price presents Margaret Courtney, Shonda Ellis, and Sheila Grant in Not Wanted on the Voyage by William Ingram.
Hello and welcome. Just one simple adjective would suffice to sum up the character of Henrietta Forsyth: dominating. To control, to have dominion over. It was her lodestone, her raison d'etre. Immensely wealthy from birth, an heiress in her own right, she possessed an unswerving instinct for multiplying that wealth. It would have been a foolhardy stockbroker indeed who did not keep at least one wary eye on Forsyth Holdings. Holdings. The term was as appropriate as it was all-embracing. She held in the palm of her hand shipping, printing, textiles. These were the makings of her empire, an empire over which she yielded despotic control. She was also a cripple. The exact nature of her disability was a mystery. Her enemies, and they were legion, claimed she simply indulged herself in her wheelchair image. It became her throne. For those of her loyal subjects forced to look up to it, just one more symbol of her power and despotism. But for her own more immediate entourage, particularly her recently acquired husband, Carlos Mendoza, it stood for something more. Half her age, South American, with an aristocratic background but no private means, Henrietta had simply indulged herself in him, a thoroughbred stallion. For his part, Carlos had reckoned he could accept the terms of the arrangement, but it was not to be. With the passing of time, he could only dwell on his own inadequacy, his own pathetic dependence on her. It was a throne that had to be toppled.
Evelyn. So this is where you've been hiding yourself.
The exile is far from self-imposed, I do assure you.
I thought we'd arranged to slip down to the village for a drink.
Well, as you can see, Her Highness arranged otherwise.
But she had no way of knowing, surely.
Do I detect a certain panic in his master's
voice?
All
I meant was, as far as we're concerned...
As far, but no further. That about sums it up. Well, doesn't it?
It's just that I'm...
Put your mind at rest, she doesn't know. A certain instinct, perhaps... Even the undivine have flashes of it, hence the chores. It was nothing that couldn't have waited, but idle hands.
Idle work, I know. The loaves for company.
Mm-hmm.
The damn great roars parked outside the front.
Oh, Harley Street Brigade.
Sorry?
Oh, the medical fraternity come a-visiting.
I thought she'd booted out.
Hardly. This one comes highly recommended. He also has a knighthood, which probably means he'll last at least a fortnight longer than any of the rest. Ring for tea, will you?
Yes.
The great man must just have about earned his 100 guineas worth. You know the hell she plays if it isn't served promptly on the stroke of 4.
Come here. I said come here.
Isn't Carlos being just a trifle foolhardy?
Yes, yes.
Caution to the wind.
There are times when there just doesn't seem to be any alternative.
No choice.
As far as Henriette and I are concerned, for God's sake, you know the way things stand.
Oh, as well as anybody. Better than most.
Signed, sealed, delivered.
For God's sake! You're making it sound as damned official as one of those dreary contractual agreements I've just been sifting through.
If you want to put it like that.
Well?
Well, what it amounts to, unwritten, unspoken even. Perhaps even more binding because of that.
Only because you allow it to be.
A flaw in my character?
Oh, I didn't mean...
Of course you did. It doesn't hurt anymore. How could it? When Henrietta spends half her waking hours reminding me of the fact... Not even the need. I spend all mine doing the reminding for her.
Come in. Thank you, Lucy. Shall I pour?
No, better wait. 30 seconds to count down. Hello? Seems we're to lose our illustrious medical gent. Certainly not to be invited into the menage. Send Dr. Crippen packing and think what we'll save on the Darjeeling.
Carlos.
Yes, Ingrid.
If we'd met before...
Oh, yes.
Do you think things might have been...
Stop. You can start boring now. Dead on cue.
Open the door, then. Or are you under the impression you're working for an octopus? Go, then. Go. Leave me to my own pathetic devices.
Let me bring you to the table, dearest.
Your tea, Mrs. Mendoza.
Think so, too.
All right, darling.
Too much sugar, too little milk, given up expecting. Why the extra cup?
We thought the doctor might be joining us.
No, an urgent summons. Some dreary duchess with a tamping migraine.
How did the consultation go anyway?
Consultation, no less. My, aren't we being grand? Well, he was suitably solicitous come obsequious. The usual quack twaddle. A change of scene. Get away from it all.
Well, he could be right.
He was. That's why I'm following his instructions.
Oh?
Did you know they just christened a liner after me?
You did mention.
The SS Forsyth. Sweet of them, wasn't it? Of course, the fact that I own the line might just have had something to do with it. Anyway, her maiden voyage bound for South America. Sails in a week. Evening will make all the arrangements.
South America?
Oh, Carlo, darling, such a glum little face. I should have thought you'd be delighted. A chance to reacquaint yourself with your roots. Essential we never forget our roots, isn't it? Now I can see Evelyn has something on her little mind.
Only to ask if you'll be wanting me to accompany you.
Want? Positively top priority, my dear. One of the family. Just me, you, and Carlos. All the comforts of home. Carl Amio?
Yes?
Stop looking like a little boy just caught filtering the dram and pass me one of those patty sandwiches.
I am sorry to have to trouble you with such wearisome domestic arrangements, Captain. I realize what I have to say is probably very much a purser's territory, but at my wife's insistence...
Stayed to the top, man. Well, in Miss Forsyth's case, I'm sure we can make the exception.
Thank you. As I expect, you've been made aware that my wife is in, shall we say, a somewhat delicate state of health.
Well, I'm sure we'll be able to cope with any medical eventuality.
But you may still remain unaware that the nature of her condition has in recent years made her into a, shall we say, something of a recluse. Privacy, anonymity are of the essence.
I see.
For that reason, she has asked me to decline her customary place at the captain's table, preferring to spend the voyage almost exclusively in the confines of her own suite.
As she prefers.
There are certain matters of a more specific nature she has asked me to bring to your attention. You will already have been instructed that her name be restricted from any passenger list or publicity material intended for public consumption.
Before embarkation.
Mm-hmm. That the deck area immediately fronting the suite be declared out of bounds to passengers and crew alike.
Inconvenient, but understood.
Uh-huh. My wife is constantly attended by her personal secretary, Miss Vincent, so the need for steward service will be minimal.
If you would prefer, we could change the original arrangements and offer Miss Vincent accommodation on the same deck, an adjoining cabin even.
No. One deck below will be perfectly adequate, Captain. Availability without proximity. The cruise being in the nature of a second honeymoon, my wife and I would prefer... But then I'm sure you'll understand.
Perfectly.
Now, where were we? Oh, yes, we travel our own linen. Instructions concerning my wife's special diet are already in the hands of your purser. Priority bookings for ship to shore have been arranged. Apart from that, that seems to cover it.
It's almost as though she isn't aboard my ship at all.
Yes, it is. Isn't it? Which I find utterly unnecessary and faintly ridiculous.
Self-imposed exile, my pet. And why on earth should you?
If only because I predicted it would happen right from the outset.
Did you really? I don't recall.
Even on our honeymoon.
Ah. Special circumstances.
You know how you hate this damn stupid shipboard ritual.
So I shall enjoy myself all the more when we arrive. Oh, now, stop pouting and let me fix your tie. Bend on. Besides, not as though for one moment I expect you to incarcerate yourself as well. Far from it. I'll be perfectly happy on my little own while you can...
What?
Well, now, how would the glossy brochure put it? Enjoy the vicarious delights of this floating pleasure drone. There we are.
And come back here to suffer the petulant consequences?
Your jacket needs brushing. Anyway, nothing of the kind. Why, I brought Sweet Evelyn along.
I don't see where the hell Sweet Evelyn comes into it. Why did you bring her along anyway?
We can't always be thinking only of ourselves, darling. God knows I worked the poor girl hard enough. Think of it as a reward. A golden opportunity to bring her out of herself. Knock some of the edges off her somewhat dowdy image. I'm relying on you for that, darling.
Are you?
But you know I am.
I'll just finish dressing.
Come!
I hope I'm not intruding. Well, the dinner call went some time ago.
So it did, my dear. Carlos, you're keeping Evelyn waiting.
Your supper tray. Will you have it now?
No, just put it down. Any old place will do. But you seem rather nervous.
Do I? Yes, I suppose so.
Well, you've no need to be. That new dress suits you to perfection. Quite the belle of the ball. Wouldn't you agree, Carlos? Of course he would. Carlos, be a pet. Get my silly trinket box from the bedroom. If I might suggest, I think something at the throat...
No, I couldn't possibly.
Nonsense. Thank you, Carlo. Now, what about this? The very thing. Carlos, dear, fix the clasp for Evelyn. I insist. Now, stand back and let me inspect the pair of you. Perfection. Positive perfection.
Good evening.
Ah, good evening, Captain. Good evening.
May I inquire after Miss Forsyth?
She's fine. Decided on a supper tray and an early night.
But everything to your own satisfaction.
Perfect.
If you'll excuse me, then.
Of course. Perfect.
And it really is, isn't it?
Perfect. For as the liner moved south to Carlos and Evelyn, so it seemed. Luminous days, intimate evenings, perfect. Because this is what Henrietta had allowed it to be, meant it to be. Oh, the young couple might have felt a certain sense of suspicion, guardedness, to begin with, but Henrietta was far too wily a trapper not to have allowed for that. As the relationship blossomed, she seemed to grow even less aware that anything was amiss. Carlos was encouraged to invite Evelyn back for a nightcap before retiring to her own quarters. A chance to catch up on the evening's excursion, the shipboard gossip. It became a ritual, and when Henrietta started retiring early, leaving the young things to their own resources, well, that became ritual too, but of an altogether more intimate and dangerous nature.
No, no, Carlos. Not in the corridor, not here. It's too...
What, dangerous? Then invite me in. Just for a minute or two.
Goodness, I want to. Oh, you know that.
Well, then. Well, then.
She'll be expecting you back.
Sleep.
There's no way of knowing.
Hours ago.
What if...
Shh. Here, let me... Darling, my own dear, dear darling.
Darling, my own dear, dear darling.
Henrietta.
Some light on the subject, shall we? Well, well. Surprise, surprise, my own dear darling.
It's all right, Evelyn.
My God, if you could just hear yourselves, see yourselves. An interminable wait. But well worth the price of admission. I wouldn't have missed your pathetic charade for anything. So too utterly banal, ludicrous.
How the hell did you manage to...
Come calling. Not even by invitation either. But I'm sure dear darling will forgive my inexcusable lapse.
How?
I walked. I quite simply put one little foot in front of the other and walked. Well, no way I could have maneuvered that ridiculous wheelchair down several flights of stairs, was there? No, of course there wasn't. You knew that. Counted on that. So, I walked.
My God.
With the aid of... Well, no, I don't even need the aid of this ridiculous stick any longer. Here, dear darling boy, you have it. Catch. Congratulate me, then.
How long have you been able to?
Several weeks before embarkation. The moment I despaired of doctors, I cured myself. Nothing miraculous. The motive, you see.
Motive?
To keep an eye on you, darling. And your very own dear, dear darling, of course. Why, I suggested, insisted on the cruise. Nothing like a cruise for revealing, shall we say, suppressed intimacies. I carried on with the wheelchair image. It helped no end. Poor, pathetic Henrietta, wheelchair-bound, confined to her cabin. It made you drop your guard, confirmed what I'd already suspected.
We were going to tell you.
Tell me? Tell me what? That at long last you'd found love, accepted responsibility, grown to manhood. Oh, not that, for God's sake. Not with all the goodwill in the world can good, poor, duped Henrietta be expected to swallow that.
Please.
Please, what? Please. Deny? The evidence of my own eyes, ears, thwarted experience of the child. Oh, yes. Don't ask it. Not even poor duped Henrietta can be expected to deny that. A snivelling brat. Child man. And his pathetic, washed-out tart.
Please, don't.
Bought. Paid for. Raised from the gutter to be returned to the gutter. The unstuddable stud and his whinnying whore.
Please.
Past prime. Burnt out. A toy.
Please.
A plaything. To be taken from his shelf, patted and petted,
no.
Made or broken, when I decide. Never before. Only when I...
Stop
I,
it! Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! Blanket. Towel. Something to cover her head. Anything.
There.
Yes. Yes. Something the captain said. It's almost as though she isn't aboard my ship at all. It was, wasn't it? Alone, kept apart, untroubled, never seen. The way she wanted it. Between us, we can still keep it like that. Business as usual. No one need ever know. Just the way we all want it. And it really is what we want, isn't it?
Yes, yes. But eventually they're bound to discover...
The mortal remains? Not so easy. And not over the side, that's for sure. She never ventured on deck. Cripple in a bath chair, 5 foot high. Guardrail, no. Certainly not over the side. So only one alternative, really.
Carlos?
We get her back to her cabin, my love, and store her until we get to the other side.
His pronouncement was as decisive as it was matter-of-fact, made without any feeling of self-doubt, almost in the nature of a tiresome chore that had to be effected in the best interests of all concerned. Came the next morning, and a confidence, a nonchalance, had already asserted itself when he eventually presented himself in the captain's cabin. The purpose of his visit seemed social, almost incidental.
My dear Captain, how kind. Now, where was I?
Something concerning Miss Forsyth.
Oh, yes, yes, how stupid. Well, last evening, though quite late, I think, anyway, a totally impetuous whim for a breath of fresh air, sea breezes, totally unobserved, of course. Well, moon on the water, stars, and with it being in the nature of a second honeymoon, embarrassing to admit, but I am sure that a man of the world, I'm sure you understand.
Of course.
How kind. And needless to say, I warned her about the chill of the night air.
In these latitudes, after the heat of the day.
My very point, sir. But her determination being what it is...
She's not sick. If you'd like me to send the medical officer.
No, perfectly hale and hearty.
Then I don't quite understand how I can help.
My wife's furs, Captain.
Furs?
Quite. Idiotically, her companion labeled the trunk as not wanted on the voyage. Naturally, they were, of course, dispatched to your cold storage hold.
I see.
Well, in view of last night's escapade, it now appears that they are very much wanted. The odds stole, at least, and my wife requested that...
But normally, such a hold would be sealed and not reopened until we reached our destination.
Understood. Perfectly. My very words to her. Unfortunately, the dear lady's resolve can extend to matters altogether more chilling than the night air.
I see.
Matter of minutes, the item selected, the trunk returned from whence it came.
When would it be most convenient?
But, my dear Captain, the convenience is all yours. Evening, my dear. How nice.
I thought you would never get here. That something must have gone wrong.
Wrong? What could possibly go wrong? Please don't look so tense, my dear. People will think there's something to hide. Mind if I smoke?
What did keep you?
Oh, nothing in particular. The captain needed just tiniest arm twist, and it was plain sailing. And the old fool would try making amends by pouring large measures of scotch down me. Anyway, I no sooner got back to the cabin than the steward fellow arrived with a trunk. I didn't ask him in. It might all have come as a rather nasty shock to him.
And were you able to...
Eventually. Tight squeeze, as a matter of fact. Poor Henrietta. The sedentary life, you know. She never did give a damn about poundage. I had to give the steward a helping hand to get it back on his little trolley thing.
But he must have noticed.
The faintest trace of a bushy, raised eyebrow. Some surplus stuff we found we need never have packed in the first place, I said. The large tip did the rest.
And now?
Now we keep the cabin door very firmly locked and behave exactly as we have always done. Business as usual, just as if the dear departed were still with us. Routine. You check her share prices on the ticker tape machine, transmit her business transactions on the ship to shore, pass on her complaints about the breakfast tray, the same dull drudge. Well, you should be expert.
And in 3 days' time, when we get to Rio...
You take her place, my sweet. Heavily veiled, incognito to the very end, a tiresome, complaining virago in a wheelchair. Gently trundle down a gangplank to a waiting private ambulance, and from hence to the baroque splendor of the Hotel Majestica. Oh, one small point. The eccentric old dear will be taking a small attaché case containing her liquid assets with her, of course. Jewelry, traveler's checks, the odd little extra that makes life worth living.
But What if there are problems at passport control?
My dear, a country that has given sanctuary to countless Nazis and has the poorest economy in the world is hardly going to bother about admitting a sick, eccentric millionaireess.
When will you join me?
After I've checked that all the luggage has been unloaded.
I see.
I'm sure you do. The trunk will come to the hotel with the rest of the stuff. We'll simply confine the great lady to her hotel suite until we decide to take a little drive into the interior. My dear Evelyn, do you have any idea of the size of this country? Huh? There's bound to be some little corner.
Three days later, they docked. Everything as planned, exactly as planned. Evelyn, alias poor Henrietta, safely away. Now just Carlos, alone, waiting patiently for the unloading of the rest of the luggage. A long wait, but resigned. It seems all his life he had been waiting for the right moment. Surely he can afford to wait just a little bit longer. But such a long, long wait.
Ah, Mr. Mendoza.
Oh, Captain, please. What the hell's a delay?
Not totally unexpected, sir. I thought you'd have known. On the voyage out, Miss Forsyth gave instructions some of the crew were to be signed off on arrival. Well, they got themselves a bit organized. Down tools, stopped unloading until something can be worked out.
Any idea how long?
Not the faintest, sir. If I were you, I'd cut along to your hotel.
But the luggage...
Oh, I know you're supposed to check all luggage through customs yourself, sir. But in Miss Forsyth's case, well, pretty sure something can be arranged.
No, I'll wait. I'd better wait.
It was at that moment that Carlos looked up and saw it. High overhead on a derrick hung the trunk. No mistaking it. Her initials clearly visible even at this distance. The sun, high in the sky now, asserting itself, asserting. Until the trunk, already moist with condensation, begins to thaw from the below freezing temperature of the cold storage. It was then that the first drop of her blood dropped. It splattered the immaculate whiteness of the captain's tunic. His glance followed Carlos's as the first flies began to gather. Evelyn did not stay long at the Hotel Majestica. It was never her intention to. No one paid her the slightest attention when she took the lift down to the foyer. A helpful bellboy offered to help her with a small black traveling case. But she seemed most determined to hold on to it herself. Once outside, she was soon lost in the throng. What was it that Carlos had told her on the ship? There's bound to be some little corner. Now you have some knowledge of the basic paraphernalia and implements of magic, shall we proceed? Are you eager to learn the steps that must be taken to communicate with the spirits to bring the unseen forces to bear on your behalf? Perhaps to evoke an ancient god? Or one of the legions of greater and lesser demons who are everywhere. 7,405,926, according to the Talmud. I don't think you have to fear being put to the torture. I doubt that you'll have to face the appalling, unholy terror and horror of the Inpache, walled up, sealed alive in a tomb, to await in utter hopeless abandon terror the suffocating, lingering death of starvation and madness, clawing at the pitiless stone in unimaginable darkness. You're so lucky. Aren't you glad? But there, I don't mean to frighten you, but I must warn you, the evocation of a demon is not to be taken lightly. There are dangers if you are careless or frivolous. It's not so easy a business as some idle and curious amateurs might suppose. First, you must know that nothing can be done to evoke spirits without a circle.
The mystic magic circle, symbol of eternity without beginning and without end. Anyone who enters into communication with demons must be enclosed in the magic circle under penalty of certain death. Then there should be the magical five-pointed star, the pentacle, which acts as a protection, and the hexagram, the six-pointed figure consisting of two interwoven triangles, having the power to control demons. Now that you have your magic circle, you must consecrate it. Some medieval magicians again recommend this simple form. Stand outside the circle, wave the magic wand over it, and say in a great voice, "Ban, ban, barrier that none can pass. Barrier of the gods that none may break. Barrier of heaven and earth that none can change, which no god can annul." I personally favor that particular dedication because it has such a nice ring to it, don't you think? Ban, ban. No demon could miss the point. Yes, that's my very personal favorite, but if you prefer something more mysterious and exotic, there are many efficacious formulae in Hebrew, Greek, Latin, ancient Egyptian, Assyrian, and Persian. Use the one that makes you feel most confident. That's the important thing. The one that kindles magic in your heart. For if you doubt yourself and tremble, the demons will know it and attack you. Perhaps you'd feel safer with a less ancient formula. Something a little more up to date? Well, that's easy. I'll give you the procedure that one of the most pleasant present-day English witches recommends. Oh, she's a darling. She tells us that first a triple circle must be drawn on the floor using the arafami. Then it should be marked with salt or charcoal. Each circle must be 6 inches smaller than the one surrounding it. The outside circle is then divided into the points of the compass, north, south, east, and west. Starting at the east, you should write the Hebrew word Agya. Then in the west, the word Sabaoth. And in the north, Adabi. And in the south, Javeh. Next, draw the pentacle inside the circle. Place a brazier of burning charcoal at the eastern point of the smaller circle. Now draw a triangle outside the circle to the east. Place the altar, which can be a small table draped with white linen, in the center of the circle. On the altar, you will lay out the implements of magic as follows. A brass water sprinkler filled with pure water from a spring or brook in which you have dissolved salt. Bottle spring water being pure, well, it's acceptable for this. The salt must also be absolutely pure. Pure sodium chloride, unadulterated with other substances such as alumates, dextrose, and potassium iodides found in most commercially manufactured table salt. Pure rock salt is excellent and easily obtainable. Also salt extracted from seawater by evaporation. Best of all is salt evaporated from the tears and sweat of a woman, preferably the witch herself. Then there is the censer, the athami, a hazel wand, and a sword. Each tool must be ceremonially cleaned, sprinkled with the salted water, and wrapped in white linen. Now set lighted candles around the largest circle and upon the altar. The ritual commences. Various conjurations are offered to the spirits to keep the circle safe from evil. Next, you will throw incense on the brazier and speak certain words of power to summon the spirit. The spirit will appear in the triangle you have drawn outside the circle. Can't you just picture this cheerful, ruddy-faced little English lady, dressed in baggy homespun tweeds and good stout walking shoes, her gray streaked hair twisted up in an untidy bun, bustling about the village, doing her shopping, having tea with the vicar, a white-haired old clergyman in a dog collar and gaiters, while the village mechanic changes the oil and adjusts the timing in her ancient jalopy, the putt-putting home along winding country lanes to the isolated ivory-covered house where she'll gather a few sprigs of parsley and some mint and a little deadly nightshade from her herb garden putting out a saucer of milk and a dish of fresh live tadpoles for her one-eyed tomcat, Beelzebub, hurrying with her own supper of cottage cheese, peas and carrots, and chamomile tea, so as to be sure of being ready when two of her witch friends come over at midnight. As the church clock strikes 12, they shed their tweeds, don their witch's robes, turn off the electricity at the main so as not to disturb the spirits. Then disconnect the telephone, light the candles in what they call the black parlor, and busily start drawing their circles and triangles in preparation for a night to be spent conjuring spirits, working on getting rid of the wart on Mrs. Weatherby's nose, or perhaps even cursing the manager of the Northumberland and Newcastle Bank, who has threatened to foreclose the mortgage on Briarheath Manor and force poor Sir Gerald to sell the old Deer Park to make way for some dreadful housing project for the workers at the Chittenden chemical plant. Of course, all witches are not old. Some are young and beautiful, voluptuous, seductive women, or undeveloped adolescent girls, even children. Reginald Scott, a member of Parliament born in 1538, wrote a book. Let me quote. Witches, he says, are commonly old, lame, blear-eyed, pale, foul, and full of wrinkles. They are doting scolds, mad, devilish. All this means is that Mr. Scott was a spiteful old man with no imagination, a timid, mediocre fool who didn't like witches. If he had taken the trouble to visit the Leipzig Museum of Fine Art before making this stupid prejudice statement, he would have seen a magnificent painting of a witch preparing a philtre. She is naked, young, tall, slender, and beautiful, with long golden hair and small, round breasts. There are plenty of cases of young and beautiful girls being burned for witchcraft. On the official hangman's list of a famous German witchcraft trial, Barbara Goebel, one of the victims, was described as 19 and the fairest maid in Würzburg. Also on the same list were a wizard of 11, a schoolboy, and a witch of 15. A death list from France includes two sorceresses of 17. Damnably pretty. Revenge, spite, and jealousy were often behind accusations of witchcraft. Dame Alice is rich. She must be a witch. Mistress Moland is pretty. Witch, witch. Oh, such a pity. But I'm getting off the subject, I'm sorry. But there are so many fascinating tales to tell you. Well, let's see now, where were we? Oh, yes. Let me see now, you have your implements, and you have your magic circle. Good. Shall we proceed? But remember that magic is not for the faint-hearted. You can't be too careful when dealing with demons. And you wouldn't want to spend eternity in the fires of hell now, would you? So hot. You stand there in your robes, armed with your wand, your bloodstone, and all your implements of magic. But be sure you have no base metal on your person, only gold and silver to throw at the spirits if the need arises. The brazier is burning. Sprinkle a pinch of incense on it, then a pinch of sulfur and a few drops of brandy. Good brandy, please. As the flames leap up, pronounce these words. I offer you, O Adonai, this purest incense as I offer this charcoal made of lightest wood. I offer it, O great and potent Adonai, Ilium, Eriel, and Jehovah, with all my soul and all my heart. Deign, O mighty Adonai, to accept it favorably. Now you can be sure you have the great almighty God, whatever his mystic name may be, firmly on your side. It is time to summon now the evil spirits. Have you scrupulously performed all that is required? Have you? Now, All right. Then begin to recite the following conjuration with confidence and assurance. I invoke and command thee, O cursed spirits. Ba'il, Ba'thim, Agares, Marbas, Pursan, Abigar, Amon, Botis, Valafa, Nuburus, Glassibolas. Come here to this place, instantaire. Appear immediately in human form, well-shaped in body and soul, and comply with my commands without deception of whatever, whatsoever kind. Come then in visible form and speak pleasantly, so that I may understand thy words. Come in the name of Iod, Elioim, El, Elion Gibor, Vadath, El Adonai, Tzaboth, Elohim, Tzaboth, Shadi. If thou dost not come or disobey me in any way, I will curse thee and will cause thee to be consigned to the bottomless pit where thou wilt remain until the day of judgment. Come then, appear before this circle to obey me utterly. Come in the name of Adonai.
Demons appear. Stand firm. Control your fears. One sign of fright and weakness, and they'll set upon you. Giant toads. A two-legged rabbit hopping horribly. Beware, there's an Ethiopian giant jetting fire through his eyes with a darting tongue of flame 9 inches long. A three-headed cat. Look out. Snakes are gliding under the skirts of your robes, coiling around your legs. Blast them hence with your magic wand. Be gone! You feel an invisible force pressing upon you. Exercise it. Be gone and vanish, spirit of fear. I blast thee from this hallowed circle, a sanctuary, a place made safe. Shrink to nothing as I shrink the foul name of Shabriri, Briri, Riri, Iri, Ri, Oshnotinos, Shlotinos, Notinos, Dino, Inos, Nos, Os. The invisible demon is gone. They are at bay. But they are ominous, imminent. There lurks a scaly dog without a tail, slimy green with yellow eyes, decapods and scorpions, cirripedes, scurrying mice. There a fantastic holothurian with a grinning head, a mictire with multiple claws, a rabid monkey with a cudgel, a toothless hag slithering reptilian on her belly. Take care! Dark-eyed girl, slinking seductively, smooth and voluptuous with silky hair and softly sloping flanks. She smiles. The smile of the succubus, salacious, her mouth. The awful, gaping, crimson mouth of hell, foul, toothless, spitting blood. There slithers now a monstrous, slimy snake. With the face of a newborn babe, indescribable monsters with outspread fins, bristling spikes like pterodactyls, spondylus, hogfish, flying crab beetles, disembodied, bloodied heads, crawling like centipedes, bloated babies, branchiopods, triangular, horrible reptiles, porcupine scorpions, lizard cats, vampire bats, mocking imagination, flying red-eyed rats, fish-headed hunchback, groveling, grotesque, prancing, dancing, lovely, bloody, ghastly girls, hopping, throwing filth, a beautiful baboon in royal robes, lapping, flagellating, monstrous, diabolical, obscene, Hieronymus Bosch, sulfurous, putrid, livid, gangrenous, vaporous, phosphorescent enormity. Now you command these awful spirits to do what you desire. Perhaps to reveal a secret, to foretell the future, to lead you to some secret hiding place. Perhaps you command them to torment an enemy, or help a friend, or to enchant the person whose love you passionately desire. Sometimes a host of fiendish, unruly demons will appear in hideous, visible form, as you have just experienced. But sometimes only one or two spirits will appear, perhaps grotesque, or if you're lucky, in a reasonably agreeable form.
At other times, you may only see a shadowy shape, or perhaps a bird, or a spider, or a bat. Spirits frequently appear as large buzzing flies, and sometimes you cannot see them at all, but you can only feel their presence. They're capricious. Their actions can never be anticipated with certainty. It depends to some extent upon the form of ritual used and the names of the spirits you call on to appear. As I've said, the most powerful conjurations carry the greatest peril, but that's only natural. The prudent novice in the art of conjuration will pick the spirits he wishes to summon with care and discretion. A few years ago, an undergraduate at Cambridge University, a man named Gerald York, decided to experiment with necromancy. Well, after considerable study, he collected the necessary equipment and scrupulously following instructions, he worked on summoning Thoth, an ancient Egyptian god of wisdom and inspiration. He drew the circles, inscribed them, and intoned the magic formulae in his rooms at night. And then, to his great surprise, Thoth came. Other students who helped with the ritual saw him also. Plainly and indisputably, throughout the ages, many people have been driven by some obsession, sometimes by desperation, ambition, greed, malice, revenge, lust, or passion, to carry this business to the ultimate, irrevocable, abominable extreme, a formal pact with the devil. Of course, you should never resort to this except in the case of the most dire necessity. But who knows? I'll tell you how it's done, just in case. The scene must be a place where nobody can disturb you. A hut, a ruin, a desolate heath, a crossroad, an attic, a cellar, or some secluded chamber. You make the usual preparations, a hazel wand, a knife, a bloodstone. Candles flicker, the charcoal glows, the perfumed smoke of incense drifts around you. Sulfur and brandy hiss and burn, and you begin to recite the invocation in a strong voice, without fear or hesitation. Emperor Lucifer, master of all the rebellious spirits, I beseech thee to be favorable to me in this conjuration I make upon thy great minister, Lucifuge Rofocali, as I desire to make a pact with him. I beg thee also, Prince Beelzebub, Lord of the Flies, to protect me in this undertaking. O Count Ashtoreth, favor me and cause that this very night the great Lucifuge appear unto me in human form without any evil smell or foul effluvium. And that he shall grant me, by means of the pact that I shall deliver to him, whatever I shall ask of him, O great Lucifuge. I beseech thee to leave thy dwelling in whatever region it may be, and come to this place and speak with me. Appear then instantly, or I shall torment you continually forever and ever. Now the candles fade and flicker and go out. A chill wind forces itself upon you. You feel the presence of death. Now you say, come, Lord of Blackness, Lord of Power, Lord of Death, approach, I command thee. Lucifuge Rofocal appears. The spirit replies, I cannot grant thy demand, but on condition that thou givest me thyself at the end of 20 years, so that I shall do with thee, body and soul, whatsoever shall please me. This is the solemn and terrible moment. The supreme decision must be taken. Throw him your pact, which must be written in your own hand on a small piece of virgin parchment. It shall consist of these few words and be signed with your veritable blood. Pact. I promise great Lucifuge to repay him in 20 years for all he shall give me. In witness whereof I have signed X in my blood. And how you are damned. Perhaps you're interested in present-day witchcraft. More interested, say, than in the old, old witchcraft. Do you think you might like to join a coven of witches? It's possible, you know. But they have rather strict rules. Let me tell you a little bit about them. Now, most modern covens consist of 13 witches. They choose their members very carefully. First, you will be questioned. Do you believe in reincarnation? Do you believe that witchcraft, the old religion, is the true religion? The high priestess will probe your psychic consciousness, looking for signs of unusual powers or perception, perhaps clairvoyance. She will read your vibrations, assess your aura. If she accepts you, you must study for 13 months. If you pass your tests and are accepted, you must prepare for the rites of initiation. The witches gather on a night that has been chosen by consulting the stars. A large circle is drawn on the ground with a magic knife and marked with chalk. The altar is placed in the center with the magic implements on it. Candles flicker upon the altar, incense rises, and perfume swells. There is the vessel of salted water, a white cord symbolizing unity, and a scourge, a whip, symbol of purification. The priestess sprinkles water in the circle and upon the instruments as she chants an invocation, calling on the ancient gods of north, south, west, and east. You stand outside the magic circle, waiting as the witches watch. The coven leader blindfolds you. She takes the magic knife and places its point on your heart. You feel the prick of cold steel. You hear her voice. It would be better to die than to join this coven of the old religion. With fear or doubt in your heart, she says. And you give the ritual answer. Perfect love and perfect trust. Now, hands lead you into the circle. The priestess seals the circle behind you with a gesture of the Athami. Now your hands are being bound with the cord. You are made to kneel before the altar, and your feet are also bound tightly together. Are you ready to swear that you will be true always to the art? The high priestess' voice asks imperiously. Yes. I am, I swear it. First, you must be purified. The high priestess is taking up the whip. You wait tense in anticipation. Then she strikes you 3 times. The pain stabs through your body, from your toes to your fingertips. Now 7 more strokes, then 9, then 21. But you bear it gladly. You welcome it with a strange exultation, exalted, a spiritual cleansing, a pure sense of triumph and freedom of the spirit. Now your head is anointed with oil, wine, and sprinkled with salted water. You feel a pair of lips pressed to yours, the ritual kiss of the high priestess. Then you are kissed by each of the witches present in turn. Now your hands and feet are unbound. You look around you with new eyes, as all the witches sit together with you in a circle to partake of a symbolic meal of cakes and wine. Now you will take the great oath as follows. I swear upon my mother's womb that I will never reveal any of the secrets of the art, and that I will be faithful to the art, forsaking all other faiths. This I swear by my past lives and my hopes of future lives to come. And I devote myself to utter destruction of the spirit forever if I break this, my solemn oath. Now the high priestess lights a new candle. She waves the wand to each point of the compass. Now you take the lighted candle in your right hand and, swinging the censer with your left, walk slowly around the circle. Now the high priestess presents you with the cord. You must bind her with this cord as you were bound. And you must scourge her as you were scourged, giving her 3 times as many strokes as you received. Finally, you are presented to the mighty spirits in the 4 quarters of the compass, and the dismissal is pronounced. O great spirits of fire and water, spirits of the north, the south, the east, and west, whose names are secret, Spirits of the unseen worlds, we thank you for thy presence in this place and for accepting this, our sister, into the mysteries of the craft. And thanking thee, we ask thee now to depart. Your initiation, your first initiation, is now complete. Later you will be initiated into the second degree of witchcraft. This ritual will be much like the first, except that your eyes will not be covered when you are led, bound as before, into the circle. Much later, when you are prepared, you will receive your third and final initiation into the craft. The ritual commences as before, the circles, the invocations, and then when the time comes, all the witches present remove their robes as a sign of equality and freedom, a physical and mental freedom which is believed to be inseparable from nakedness. Now you are bound. You step into the circle and kneel before the altar to be scourged. After the scourging, you are blindfolded as you were the first time. Your hands and feet are loosed, and you lie on your back in the circle, extending your limbs to the point of the compass. Further invocations are intoned. Then there follows a sexual rite performed by you with a person of the other sex, one of those present, but which one will never be revealed to you. This is the most sacred act of devotion and atonement with the ancient gods of nature, of fertility. It is the ultimate giving of yourself to the faith in body and spirit, to the life force of the universe. The physical act of love, divorced from emotional attachments and personal feelings, has been a religious rite since humanity's earliest beginnings. Witches believe it to be a profoundly mystic act of communion, and they believe there is an inherent invisible energy, like electricity, in the human body, which is sexual energy. Part of the universal cosmic forces, the raising and controlling of which is the whole basis of witchcraft. And because this life force reaches for a fleeting moment an otherwise unattainable degree of brilliance and concentration during the sexual act, they regard the act itself as sacred.